This talk is going to be about the monitoring system I have used for 6 years now, which is called Zabbix, and my sudden interest into working with logs as well, which developed 2 years ago. Contrary to what is on your program, I also put in Grafana to the topic list. This is basically a journey through what I've lived through in the last couple of years, trying to integrate information from logs with our classical monitoring. I work for a company called Geizhals. We do price comparison for all kinds of articles in Austria, in Germany, in Poland, and in the UK. I'm not representing the company here, though. I've been in the Zabbix community for a couple of years now. I've been speaking at free Zabbix conferences. I was active on the blog as well. Wrote quite a few front-end patches, and I'm also doing a book review on the upcoming Zabbix 3.0 book. In my pastime, I'm a Fedora packager. Zabbix is one of the packages I maintain in Fedora, and I'm also an OpenStreetMap contributor. So let's try to get into more details about what I'm going to say. At first, I want to get your interest sparked into how logs can be beneficial and interesting, and at the same time, how they are very, very difficult to understand and interpret. We want to have a very clearly defined goal. We don't want to do the next hip thing. We don't want to do the things Google does because we are not Google. We have different problems.
I would like to talk to you about a little bit about home automation. Who of you have experience with home automation?
I will then explain
with
the
OpenHAB
setup
or with
I have
things.
Built to reach those goals.
Fully homegrown. Okay. You might want to change.
And the last section will be about my ongoing effort.
Although I never touch a running system.
Integrating this ever more tightly.
What is home automation? What does it do? Well, basically, home automation is all sorts of things. What we can do is connect thermostats. We can
start off with
control lights. We can control. We can use sensors
to
automate particular things. For example, when the sun goes down, switch on the lights. We can control the blinds of the windows. We can do stuff with audio and video. There are people who like when their doorbell is pressed.
What the service
that a photo of the person standing in front of the door is transmitted to their phone, etc. All those kind of things are basically home automation.
This may be interlinked with
definition for it.
There are log entries.
If you use thermostats, you can set up seasonal preferences. For example, in the winter, you probably like a relic.
If the demon was restarted, this is not what would usually happen as part of your operation. Error messages are logged as well as crash information. And if you want to get down to the source of your problem, you would usually raise a log level and get lots of debugging information, which is interesting, of course, to solve particular problems, but is nothing you want in your log monitoring every day. It's just way too much information, and it's unstructured, and it could be anything. It's probably not worth collecting this and analyzing this later on. Okay, let's start off with a typical Apache access log entry. This is a single line log. It's a log that is directly written to a file by Apache. It contains lots of information. It contains the client IP address. It contains a custom timestamp with a time zone. It contains the exact request, the referrer, the response code, and some freeformish text as well, which happens to be the user agent information. If you wanted to pass this information, you have to take care of a couple of things. For instance, while the user agent may be double quoted, it may contain double quotes as well, which don't get escaped. So if you're going to grab through this, it may become difficult to get this bit of information out. Those two messages are from postfix. I found postfix probably the most complex when it comes to logging. There's like variations and variations and variations depending on how you configure it and if it can do lookups and whatnot. This message was written by a local Syslog daemon. It has a different timestamp, as you can see, a different timestamp format, I mean. It has some information about which process calls this message. It has the PID as well, and it has QID as well for this message. And this QID is one thing that connects the two messages you can see on this screen. You can also see those. What is it? Delays. Can you find it up there? That contains three numbers. And those numbers are actually metrics, so that's a bit of a mixture of information here. One thing, if you try to parse log messages and the developers decide to change the logging format, and you would never know because there is no documentation on what may be logged under whatever circumstances, it can become very difficult if you try to just parse this with regular expressions. One approach to remedy this kind of problem is pursued by Cisco with Cisco ASA log messages, which basically have an identity, which is that ASA number. The 1 and the 7 is actually the severity and not the identity of the number. And they clearly define the syntax of this message, and interface name and IP address are placeholders in this example. Apache does something very similar with their error logs, starting from version 2.4 on. This is an IP tables log with the standard log format. Some applications allow for custom log format strings, others don't. IP tables does. And this is mostly key value, mostly. Because in the end, there's a stray SYN, and that's a list of TCP flags set on this very datagram. So don't rely on everything being key value just because it looks like it. This is something we all know and love. It's a Java backtrace. It's a Jira backtrace. And what makes this one different from the previous message, this is also a multi-line message. This makes the regular expression approach even more difficult. It's very verbose too. I'm not sure what's really relevant here. Right. Let's go on to the definition of what we actually want to do. As I said before, we want to solve problems we face, not problems other companies face. We don't want to go into the new technology stuff that requires all sorts of knowledge we do not have. We want to solve our problems. We want to keep it simple. As few new technologies as possible, as versatile as possible. We may have all kinds of logging sources we want to use. One goal we have is we want to collect all the logging information in one place for several reasons. If you're operating 200 mail servers, you want to find a particular, thank you very much, a particular log message, you don't want to go to 200 servers and grab the log files. That's inefficient at best. It's also a bit of a security concern to get the logs off a machine as soon as possible, because if somebody breaks into the machine and tries to wipe the logs, you're basically lost. Or if the machine crashes, there's a certain chance you still get some logs and you may not be able to recover the old machine, but you get an idea of what was going on. And we want to search through all that information as easily as humanly possible. We want to have the capability of analyzing things like, give me the sum of all of these values that occurred in the last hour, or how many of these did happen. We want to be able to graph this as well, so it is pleasant to look at. And we want to connect this to what we have in our monitor, and we want to react to this. We want to be able to alert people on certain events. And the final goal is to be able to analyze what kind of problems we are facing in a joint effort using logs and using our classic monitoring as quickly and efficient as possible. The monitoring solution I've been using for 6 years is Zabbix. It's what you would probably call a classical monitoring system. It uses a relational database as the backend for the configuration data as well as the monitoring data. Which some people don't like. It supports various backends. It supports Oracle, DB2, PostgreSQL, MariaDB2. It consists of a number of components, daemons written in C, and front end written in PHP. Those components are the server, the proxy, and the agent. They serve different purposes. You usually have like one server, zero, or a number of proxies, and the agent installed on as many systems as you like. You're not forced to use the agent for monitoring with Zabbix. You're open to use SSH, IPMI, SNMP, custom scripts, whatever you like. It is not limited to polling data from devices. It also has a trapping mechanism, which allows a device to send data to Zabbix as it sees desire. It is a very complex thing to learn at first. If you just want to ping a couple of devices and get an email if one is down, Zabbix is not for you. You've got to invest like a day or two to wrap your hand around the concept. There's lots and lots of abstraction in it, which is something good because it's a very versatile thing, a thing you can hack, a thing you can slightly abuse to get exactly what you want. And all those monitoring systems, you may have tried a few, are very different. Some concepts may fit your company needs just fine, and others may not fit at all. How many of you have used Zabbix? Wow, I'm preaching to the choir. How many have used ELK? How many have heard the word? Okay, so everybody heard about it and also used it, obviously. Right, and Zabbix also has an API. It's a SOAP API. It is more or less part of the front end, which is not ideal and which may change in the future. Zabbix is gathering a lot of data. It can also do SLA. SLA a calculation, for instance, but it doesn't do a very good job at visualizing this data. This is something the company behind Zabbix knows and is trying to mitigate in the coming future. This is about what Zabbix 3.0, which is coming up next year, is going to look like. If you know previous releases of Zabbix, you will realize it's basically a phase change. So all the mechanisms remain the same for now, but it's more modern and there are various improvements under the hood. So it's a lot easier in 3.0 to customize your front end. Right, let's get back to what we originally wanted to do. We need to ship our logs from where they originate to a sink. And this is a difficult task because there's all kinds of protocols that devices speak. And there may be bugs in the implementations of those protocols as well. One important thing is however we ship the logs, we may never stall the application from running. That's why many people think that UDP is the perfect fit, which is not exactly or necessarily true, but I'll give some details about that later. We should also try not to lose a lot of messages, but you really have to think about the situation you're in. How dramatic is it if I lose one single message a day, which is probably an Apache access log? Does it matter to my business? Will I go bankrupt tomorrow? Probably not. If you're in the bank business and logging is of tremendous like legal importance for you, you may have to think of some mechanism that offers a good chance of not losing anything at all. So to solve this problem, we may decide to use an abstraction layer for transporting, that's like collecting things from various sources and shipping it to whatever is going to analyze and finally store things. One approach people also take is they install a specific agent on a machine that basically parses log files and ships those log files in a structured or just in a plain way. I don't feel like doing this. I don't want to install some third-party agent on any given machine. It may not even work on this platform, this operating system. This is not a very attractive solution, if you ask me. Yeah, that's what I pretty much covered. So if it's structured, there's some processing going on in that agent on that host. Some people may want to use messaging frameworks. I have absolutely no practical experience with any of them, and Kafka is one that often comes up in this context. It's Java. I'm not a big fan of Java. I don't want to make it more complicated for me, actually. I want to do something simple. And it suddenly comes to my mind that Zabbix can do logs as well. So why don't we just use this? First off, to let Zabbix read logs, we need an agent installed on the machine. You can do that on a Linux server, you can do it on a Windows server, you can do that on an ELK server, but you cannot do this on your switch. Or usually, you cannot. What makes it more difficult, there's two modes of operations when it comes to the Zabbix agent, and it has to be in that one mode, in that active mode, which doesn't scale particularly well, and is not possible everywhere. It's a connectivity issue, who is going to connect to whom. The whole thing is file-based as well. It basically gets a couple of patterns it's looking for, and if it detects a line matching this pattern, it will report it to the server, which basically means we need to allow the agent access to the file. And that's probably not the safest thing to do. And it's not very fine-grained, too. It's like, okay, read everything from while log messages. That's probably not what I want this agent to do. It can only grab complete lines and report those to Zabbix or extract one value. This does not resemble the complexity of a postfix log. It's also not very flexible when it comes to the date format. It has no notion of what Sun for Sunday stands for instance. I'm not sure if it supports time zones, does it? Okay, so time zones are supported. And the whole thing is POSIX regular expression based, which may work fine for single lines, which does not work very well for multiple lines. And regular expressions are hard. It can become very difficult. Have you ever tried to build a perfectly valid regular expression for an IP address or an email address, to give a simple example? It sounds very basic at first, but it can become very complex, and it's an expression this long. We don't want to write those. What is worse, that information that Zabbix is then collecting cannot be graphed in a meaningful way, unless we just extracted a number. We can graph a number, but we can not graph like how many occurrences of this and that message did we have in the last hour. And we cannot search through it either. Please show me all the records with string ABC. That's not possible within Zabbix. And it becomes even less attractive if you want to look at logs coming from different hosts. Why don't we just use Rsyslog? Rsyslog has been around for ages. It's a heritage of sendmail. about every device can speak Syslog. And what would usually pop up if you suggest this is that Syslog has various limitations. It doesn't support time zones very well. There's different standards. There's mistakes in implementations, making it even more difficult. The information is not really trustworthy. There's a length limit as well. All that kind of limitations are there. But the question is this relevant for you? Is this relevant for your application? And in many cases, I feel it is not relevant. Or there are ways to work around this. And I'll show a few later on. Syslog daemons are usually written in C or similar languages, so they are fairly close to being as efficient as they possibly can, and are fairly robust too, in my experience. So this is the kind of setup, or a simplified view of the setup I am using. I've got a Syslog daemon on any remote system, forwarding all the messages I tell it to one or even several, if you want to, Syslog servers. Those Syslog servers then forward those messages to Logstash for processing if necessary, or store them in files themselves, or send them to Elasticsearch, which is what we are using as the final backend for our logs directly. So we've got the shipping covered. We're doing a syslog. We've got the processing covered for analysis. That's what Logstash does for us. And we need a front end to view all this. And this front end is the one in pink here. It's Kibana. It directly accesses the database to give us a graphical view on our data. So what is Rsyslog? Rsyslog is a modern Syslog implementation. It's the one I use. It's been the standard on RHEL 6. I don't know if it's still there for RHEL 7, which brings me to an... Thank you. Okay, it is there. Which brings me to an important point. There's this new thing called SystemD, and it has that other new thing called JournalD, which is the new thing for logging. Why don't we use JournalD for logging? Is Syslog still relevant if JournalD is present? And the answer is the two operate very well together. JournalD is actually doing the recording of messages and is more or less forwarding them to the Syslog implementation of your choice, so you can easily continue using Syslog. And JournalD is probably not there yet to replace it for us. It can ship logs to different hosts for a couple of releases now, but there's no filtering, for instance. But there are some advantages it offers. For instance, some fields are guaranteed to be true when it comes to their content. You cannot forge a process ID, for instance, which is something you can easily do with Syslog. Rsyslog has a number of improvements over all the Syslog implementations. For instance, it offers transport not only via UDP, but also via TCP. For this to work, there's a concept of queues. So you can have disk-assisted or just in-memory queues to buffer your messages and possibly discard some of them if the connection to your like central Syslog server breaks down. And it also has a protocol called RELP, which allows for application level acknowledge of messages being received, because there is still a window of opportunity to lose something even if you're using TCP. Rsyslog has a number of output modules, and one you're probably all using if you're using Syslog is the OM file module, which is writing files. But it also supports writing to Elasticsearch directly, several relational database management systems, and it has a TCP output as well. And this is what we are going to send to Logstash for processing. It's actually not the raw syslog message we're going to send to Logstash, but it's a JSONified version, which is basically the timestamp of the syslog message is something we don't need to pass later on. Syslog knows that this is the timestamp, so we can send the timestamp, we can send the syslog tag, we can send the host name. So some of the parsing is already done in our syslog, in my setup, if you will. One upside of our syslog is it also exists for Windows. So if you have to administer Windows as well, this is probably the most viable solution to get your log messages off of those systems. A buzzword always coming up is structured logging, which usually means somebody has packed some information into a JSON object and is shipping this by some means. And syslog can do this too. A couple of years ago, there was an enhancement to, or a proposed enhancement to the syslog standard, which is called CEE. And it basically is a plain syslog message with a so-called CEE cookie. And everything coming after that CE cookie is interpreted as a JSON object and understood by our syslog. JSON is UTF-8, which can be a problem if you don't know what kind of encoding your messages contain, something that may happen on mail servers, for instance. And it allows for some in-depth structure as well. I have nested an array in there at the end. Key-free has another array. Right. I mentioned Logstash already as the thing doing the processing. It's a JRuby-based pipe, if you will. It has an input. It does something in between to the message. And there's an output stage as well. And there's a filter or plugin system. Sorry, not a filter, but a plugin system for each and every stage, so you can receive events per email or per IRC or per SNMP traps, syslog, whatever. That's what the input stage does. Those can be interpreted as whatever data format they are. That's what the codec is. And there's a couple of very useful filters. Remember me mentioning how regular expressions are hard before? The solution that Logstash uses is called grok. This is basically, you write a pattern, you give it a name, and you can use the name from then on, and you can cascade. And it's very easy to understand and read, and very easy and comfortable to work with. That's a very useful filter if you have to do parsing. There's a KV filter, key value. If you're in the situation we are pretty much in with the IP tables log, you can just say, okay, key and value are separated by an equal sign, just parse that. CSV for CSV formatted information. And there's also a couple of plugins to enrich information, like the GYP plugin, which you can give an IP address to look up information for. And you can also have your custom Ruby plugins. And this can be very problematic, because if you're doing any mistake there, you may crash the whole thing. And there's several output filters as well. And the ones that I am using mainly is the Elasticsearch output filter, or output module, sorry, and Zabbix one, which we use. Thank you. Which we use for trapping information to Zabbix. So our backend is Elasticsearch. It's a Java-based document storage system built on top of Lucene, meant to scale easy horizontally. How true that promise is, you have to find out in practice. There's a certain truth in it, but it's easy to crash it, and it's easy to lose data as well. Still, it's not something to take very lighthearted. The whole thing basically operates on a RESTful HTTP JSON API, which you use for submitting data as well as retrieving data. And the permission module of Elasticsearch is non-existent, if you will, and the company behind it is offering an additional product to implement some kind of separation in permissions. Kibana, or more concretely, Kibana 4, is the new generation of the front end the very same company that produces Logstash and Elasticsearch is offering for accessing your documents you store in Elasticsearch. It's Node.js based, and it only accepts Elasticsearch as the backend for data, which kind of is limiting its usefulness for me. And to find what you want to find, you can use Lucene queries, and there's all kinds of aggregations, and can do all kinds of fancy graphs. Though it is not there yet. There's still lots of things to develop. They basically threw away the code base they had with Kibana 3. And I find Kibana 4 a little bit less interactive, more complicated to use, but I hope they'll get there. And Kibana as well has no permission model whatsoever. And it also attempts to break the length limits when it comes to HTTP GET requests, because all the information is in a GET request. I wonder when this is going to break. Most HTTP implementations accept like 8,000 characters. Anyway, this is about what a Kibana 4 dashboard looks like. As you can see, it has different kinds of graphs, and it's also offering tables, which you can customize to display the information you want, and you can shift through a range of time and whatnot. Do we have to use Logstash and Kibana? The answer is no. There's another company with a product called Greylog 2, and if I had to start anew, I would probably consider Greylog 2 because it has some things that Logstash has not. It has some kind of introspection. You can do the configuration online. You don't have to restart it and find out that there is a syntax error, and it's, well, it can be messy. It also has a concept of streams, which is basically a filter for a kind of events you can hook into and react on later. And Mozilla is also having a project on their own called Heka. The whole concepts are not all that different, though. And here's another product I announced before. It's called Grafana. It's another web-based graphing frontend. It is used for time-based data mostly, so it does not offer the searching and tabular views and all that Kibana has. But what makes it very attractive for me is it has numerous data sources it can hook into, and with the new 2.5 release, it can also use Elasticsearch. And a person named Alexander Sobnin was kind enough to write a plugin that can hook into the Zabbix API to retrieve data there. This product allows us to graph in one interface our monitoring data and logging data, maybe metrics data. So that's a lot more versatile than anything we could have within Zabbix or that we could have within Kibana. It also has permission a model, and you can do all kind of templated dashboards where you can have like do one graph or one network interface for how many interfaces the host has. This should give you an impression of what Grafana is capable of. It's highly customizable. You can have like bar charts and line charts in the same graph. You're very flexible, and it has mouse over effects and all the fancy things you would expect. Right, and now we come to the part where we try to integrate Zabbix with ELK. And that's a list of things that can be done. The first one we want is graph things together. I already gave you a small peek into Grafana. We also want to navigate from one front end to the other with some context. We will not have one front end that does all the things we need. First, we want to navigate efficiently between them. So if we're looking up information from one host, we also want to see the log information for that host with as little clicking around as necessary. Zabbix has a notion of host groups. If you set up those host groups properly, they probably mean something to you, and you want that same context on your logs as well. Like if you have a group production servers, you want that on your log messages too, because you may not know by heart which one is which. Logstash allows you to send data to Zabbix on a concrete event. And if this is not an option for you, you are also able to pull data from Elasticsearch. Like, show me how many 500 responses our Apache gave us in the last hour. Zabbix events is something we want to have in Logstash as well. We may want to use this on graphs as a marker, like here, this is where something happened. A monitoring system responded, like we had too many resources used or whatever. And something very similar is if you're doing lots of development, you may push a new deployment to information, and that might change the performance of your application. And it's very handy to have a marker there as well, showing the information of like the commit you pushed out. And the last thing I'm going to talk about is having the logs of the Zabbix daemons as well in Logstash, because you could never graph that in Zabbix. Like, how many times did that host go disabled due to an internal error? There are various shortcomings in the way Zabbix does graphing, and I'll show a small comparison later. Kibana only supports Elasticsearch, as I said before. None of them offers a complete set of what any other does. And I don't see a way to actually integrate the one. That's why we are using them in parallel. This is just a small comparison of a Zabbix chart next to the very same thing in Grafana. It is a lot more interactive. You could just click on one set of data and just hide the other ones. You can have different scales. You can have logarithmic scales. You have a mouse over. You can have different transparencies. And it's very flexible. This is pretty much the visual representation of what I said before, Grafana being like the best solution to cover all our graphing needs. If we want to navigate to Grafana to view graphs, or to logs to Kibana to view logs for a specific host from within Zabbix, we may want to use something that is already there, and that's a small menu you get in Zabbix a lot. When you click on a host, you get a menu of things you may want to do. And what I'm trying to do at the moment, and it's still work in progress, is hook into this and just have very flexible references to Grafana dashboards and Kibana dashboards. This is pretty much what this menu looks like. You click on a host, you get this menu, and usually you only have things like the one I highlighted in orange, like, oh, go to the host graphs within Zabbix. What I had added here at the bottom is a new section, which you can cascade, which will leave you to the relevant template dashboards in Grafana. That's about tagging the log messages with a Zabbix context. I've written a blog, or not a blog article, but a wiki article about this. You basically utilize the Zabbix API to get the group information, write it down to a file, and use an existing filter plugin in Logstash to attach this information. And this is what it looks like. Based on the name of the host, you can see at the top, more work. It adds a Zabbix context, and this host is in two host groups, web services and Linux servers. So you can use Kibana to look for all the logs on your web services host, and you would find this one along with many other. Sending data from Logstash to Zabbix is done with an output plugin. You basically have to know what the item is called you're sending to. So you have to set things up in Zabbix first, which is a bit of an annoyance, but you get used to it. What you want to do then is you want to define a trigger, which gives you multiple events. So each time something happens there, it would would trigger off and send you an alert or something. And this method uses the Zabbix sender protocol for trapping the data. Pulling data from Elasticsearch is as easy as having a script using curl or any scripting language with a module for HTTP that understands JSON. You would have your pre-constructed JSON object query because Elasticsearch queries tend to be huge. It's nothing you just enter. It's not like an SQL query. And you would just send it, get the response, and do whatever you want in your monitoring system. It doesn't matter how you get it to your monitoring system. There's many ways to do this. Sending events that happen inside Zabbix, like we are using too many resources, is something you can do in many ways too. Essentially, you want to get it into Elasticsearch, and you're really open to implement it in a couple of ways. Unfortunately, in Grafana, events can only be shown as like a line, a point in time, not as a range in time, so there are no Gantt charts now in any of the graphing solutions yet, unfortunately. sending deployment messages for your Git messages or just some freeform messages is fairly easy. You basically have to get the stuff into Elasticsearch by any means. For instance, write a hook script that uses Syslog CEE to send the structured data to Elasticsearch and happily use it in Grafana. You can see this random graph and you can see the red lines, and if you mouse over them, you get the information that you sent. So we can see that at around 8 p.m. there was this Git commit pushed into production on our services. Yeah, and that's the last one. Just using your regular Syslog facilities to send the Zabbix daemon logs, not to a log file, but to your Syslog servers for your convenience to graph and analyze later on, along with all your other data. So this is pretty much it. I think there's quite some potential in integrating this further. As you saw, it's work in progress. Some things can be done a lot more efficiently. Some things would need some testing and automatisms to be less of a hassle. I don't think that the situation would become a lot easier soon. And you probably want to use a meta interface for all the data on top of that as well. But that is really up to you. Here's a small number of readings that you may enjoy. There's a nice and very cheap book on Logstash that gives you an easy start. It's called Logstash Book. I think it's like $10, and you get an update for free. And there's a collection of snippets for Logstash available by Cool Acid. That's something to look at as well if you're a beginner or if you're just curious. And this presentation is already available for download in the... That's the address where you can download it. Thank you very much. I'm open to questions now, if we have the time. It was all very quick.
Is it possible to do some statistical analysis, or is that Elasticsearch part?
It depends on what you want. You can do median and standard deviation and percentiles and that kind of stuff quite easily. Newer versions of Elasticsearch offer more features in this field, but you can also just hook in your statistics application and just use Elasticsearch as the backend as well.
In one of your examples, you let Rsyslog log directly to Elasticsearch instead of Logstash. What are the advantages by doing that?
The advantages are, if I'm receiving the JSON information I want already and I don't need to do any further processing on it, I don't want to delete anything from it, I don't want to enrich from it, it is just way more efficient. Just approach me outdoors if you have any further questions or remarks.